And I'm going to preach the hell out of you.
Amen.
Listen to the word. Don't fool yourselves. Those who indulge in sexual sin. Stop. Don't go to the next PowerPoint. Stop right there. I'm first on the list. So please understand, I'm first on the list. At 11 years old, one of my friends introduced me to pornography. It very quickly went to hardcore pornography. High school, I would sit in classes and literally undress girls and go through the wildest sexual fantasies. I was consumed with lust. In 1982, I'm a 23-year-old man now. I marry whom I consider to be the most beautiful girl that walks the planet. And I think everything's going to be fine. No, it's getting worse. You know, I was like a magnet, and pornography was like metal shavings. If there was any pornography anywhere, it would be like... And it's affecting Lisa's and my relationship in bed. I mean, it's not good. And then in 1983, I go into ministry. And I'm still eating up with this lust. I'm working for my church. I'm driving the vehicle, picking up the guest speakers. We had guest speakers from all over the world come to our church. It was one of the best known churches in America. And I remember in 1984, the fall of 1984, I am alone in the church vehicle with a man named Lester Sumrall. Okay? This man, and I know a lot of you young people will not know who he is, he had one of the greatest deliverance ministries on the planet in the 20th century. I'm alone with him, and I open up. This is the fall of 1984. I said, Brother Sumrall, I am bound to lust. And I share with him. And man, I'm telling you, he rebuked me like a good dad. And I listened to every word he said. And I said, Brother Sumrall, will you lay your hands on me and get me free from this? He said, absolutely, come here. Pray a strong prayer. You know what happened? Nothing. Nothing. Not a thing. Well, you better find somebody with a more powerful anointing and gift on their life. You're not going to find anybody more powerful than Lester Sumrall. 9 months later, we're in the spring of 1985. And a man gives me his condominium to use for 4 days. I go on a 4-day fast. And the fourth day of the fast, I got completely set free from pornography. And I'm free today.
Looks like a good book.
Let's pray.
King Jesus, we just come to you. And Lord, we're seeking your word. And we're seeking, Lord, for you to speak to our hearts and do something in our lives that we can't do ourselves. Really, it's your grace that comes and empowers us. So we ask right now, pour out your grace, pour out your spirit. And Lord, may we see you and experience your word in a fresh way this morning. It will touch and change our lives.
Yes, Lord.
In Jesus' name. Amen. We'll get all these lights on, sir. I feel so strong this morning, the fear of the Lord just resting on me. Because I feel like there are destinies that are hanging in the balance this morning. I'm not trying to be ominous this morning, but I feel like right now, there are people that are at a crossroads in your life and in your heart. And you're trying to decide whether or not to go the way that you know God is calling you to go. Does that speak to anyone in here this morning? Just wave at me. You're trying to figure out. So like half of you are honest, the other half of you are like, I don't know, I should put my hand up. And I just feel like crying this morning because this thing is so heavy on me. And it's like a weight that's just, it's like the burden of the Lord. And I feel it for you. Like I can feel that the enemy is, some of you, the enemy is just trying to pull you. He's trying to convince you. You've given space in your head, trying to convince yourself, this is okay. I mean, it's not, I'm not killing anyone. I'm not murdering anyone. I'm not raping anyone. I'm just doing my own thing. Just going to do my own thing. And God's going to love me. Even my daughter is crying about it right now. Sad. And my assignment this morning is to tell you about God's covenant commitment to you. And that we're going to read in a moment. His word says, I'm never going to leave you. I'm never going to forsake you.
Amen.
And that's not what's hanging in the balance. His heart toward you and his stance towards you never changes. He just doesn't change. It's one of the things I love about God. It's one of the things I love about Jesus. He just never changes. He's just always there. Like you can totally just like kick dirt in his face and tell Jesus, there's children in the room. But you can tell Jesus, go away. I don't want anything to do with you. Go do your own thing. Just totally snuff him off. Come back in 5 years, 10 years, 20 years, 50 years, and there he is. Yeah. Arms wide open. He just doesn't change. He's the only constant in the universe. He doesn't change. The word says in Hebrews 13, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's always there. Every time you come to him, he's waiting for you, arms wide open. There's nobody like that. There's no person like that. So that's not hanging in the balance. That's a fixed. That's a constant. What's hanging in the balance, I feel it so strong, is the destiny and the calling and the purpose of God over your life. That's why the Bible says in Proverbs chapter 1 and all over the word, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Because when we understand, like, your life apart from the will, there is nothing, everyone say this with me, there is nothing good for me apart from the will of God. There's nothing good for me apart from the will of God. Nothing. Yeah, sure, it feels good in the moment. But in the end, let's open the word this morning to Hebrews 13. Last week we preached subject of covenant and you know what's hanging in the balance is a fruitful life. Guys, hear my heart. I've been in church now. In church. I've been saved for 18 years. I've been in church for 18 years. Like every week, multiple times. And I've seen this over and over again. Believers sitting in church for years, decades, sitting in church. They're in church. There is, and they have a love for God. They're just like Mark. You know, Mark's a great example. Thank you, Mark, for this. Of somebody that was just willing. He walked into our little church, our little youth ministry, about 8 years ago, and he goes, what is this? This is crazy. I don't like this. Just wanted to make sure that his beautiful daughter at the age of 14, 15 wasn't, you know, getting involved in a cult. So, goes and checks it out, and I see this big guy standing in the back. And he's there the next week. And he's there, but like I could tell, like, didn't really want to be there. Because we did church on Friday night, every Friday night. And I'm sure there's some kind of football game or something going on, movie night with the wife, and all of a sudden I meet Renee. Then Mark comes up to me about 1 month into him coming, and he's kind of trembling, and he says, "Pastor Josh, God's telling me to join your church. But I don't want to." Because Mark's wrestling with God and saying, "Lord, this blue-haired pastor," and at the time I had dyed my hair blue. And you know why? The only reason I did it is because I thought it would help me reach kids. I'll be crazy, God. You want me to die? I felt like the Holy Spirit telling me, dye your hair blue. I haven't done it since. Like, it wasn't like a thing, right? I wasn't like blue, orange. I wasn't trying to... I said, "God, why blue?" And he said, "Because you're going to be a river wherever you go. Prophesy to yourself. You're going to be a river of life wherever you go." So Mark's wrestling with God, saying, "God, it's good, but it's not good. What do you want me to do?" And then God gave him a vision of him putting this, like, like a tomato plant, right? You put this basket so that give the tomato plant structure so they can grow up. He said, "That's what I want you to do. I want you to bring some structure. I want you to bring your gift, and I want you to utilize your life energy." He didn't say all this, I'm ad-libbing, but I want you to use your life, and I want you to go be, there's fruit, there's a covenant. You happy now, Mark?
Well, yes, I am, because I see the fruit, and we've seen a lot of people come, and we've seen some people go, and some people stay. But one thing that I remember, we were doing men's group, and after men's group, I said, "Hey, Josh, I want to be your friend." You probably don't remember this. I said, "Hey, Josh, I want us to work together. You're my friend." And you know what he said? He kind of stood back a bit and said, "Mark, I've had some people say that before, and they left." I went, "That's not very encouraging." And I said, "I want to be your friend."
And then?
Still together.
Let's give Mark a hand clap, because he's awesome. Well, no. Talked about it before, but this is what happens. People, they come and they go, "Oh, Josh, you're amazing, and I'm with you. I'm gonna work with you. I'm with you. And they're with me until God puts His hand on them and says, "Okay, now it's time to get to work." And He gives them a piece of the warfare. You might not get that. I said, "God, we only have about 22 people, 22 men coming on encounter. I wanted 50. God spoke to me this morning again, because I was praying about it and struggling with it. And just like, God, He said, "You don't have the infrastructure for 50. You're where you're at." You know, God does everything He can with what you give Him.
Yeah.
God right now is moving in this city to the extent that He can with what we give Him.
Yeah.
He's moving in your life
to
the extent that you've given Him your life.
Yeah.
"God, where are you?" We say sometimes, and He says, "I'm right here." "God, I need you to move in my life." He says, I'm moving. But will you give me more? If you give him more, he'll move more. If you surrender more, he'll touch you more. If you give, if you love him more, you'll feel his love more. One thing I've learned about marriage is not about feelings primarily, it's about commitment.
Amen.
Love, I've learned, is commitment.
Right.
First, it's a choice. First. Hebrews 13, let brotherly love continue. Amen. Do not neglect to show hospitality to strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels unawares. Remember those who are in prison as though in prison with them, and those who are mistreated, since you are also in the body. Let marriage be held in honor among all, and let the marriage bed be undefiled. For God will judge the sexually immoral and the adulterous. Keep your life free from love of money, and be content with what you have. For he has said, I will never leave you or forsake you. So we can confidently say, the Lord is my helper. I will not fear. What can man do to me? Remember your leaders, those who spoke to you the word of God. Consider the outcome of their way of life and imitate their faith. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Do not be led away by diverse and strange teachings, for it is good for the heart to be strengthened by grace, not by foods which have not benefited those devoted to them. We have an altar from which those who serve the tent have no right to eat, for the bodies of those animals whose blood is brought into the holy places by the high priest as a sacrifice for sin are burned outside the camp. So Jesus also suffered outside the gate in order to sanctify the people through his own blood. Therefore, let us go outside the camp and bear the reproach he endured. For here we have no lasting city, but we seek the city that is to come. Through him then, let us continually offer up a sacrifice of praise to God. That is, the fruit of lips that acknowledge his name. Do not neglect to do good and share what you have. For such sacrifices are pleasing to God. I feel like it's my assignment this morning to tell you very clearly, very plainly, God is with you. He loves you. He's never going to leave you. He's never going to forsake you. What's in the balance right now is, will you choose him? We sang about it prophetically this morning. I choose you. I choose you. I choose you. I choose you. There's some things in your life that you're never going to feel. Like, initially, you're never going to feel like doing what God asks you to do until you begin to do it. There's some sin that you're never going to feel like you're never going to just magically wake up and it's going to change. You are going to have to become intentional. I tell you, God is intentional towards you. You don't think God gets angry? Sometimes he gets angry. You just got to read the Bible and you understand very clearly all, everyone say all. Uh-huh. All of the emotion that you experience, God experiences that emotion. He is an emotional God. He experiences laughter. The Bible says God laughs and rejoices over you. Actually, in the Hebrew, it's in the book of one of those books in the back. Zephaniah. God says he rejoices over you with twirling and dancing. I gotta tell you, he loves you. God so loved you so much. God so loved the world that he gave his son. He gave his son to spill his blood. Strapped onto God so loved you, he so wants to touch you and heal you and restore you that he gave the back of his son to be whipped over and over and over, the flesh torn off his body. So the Bible says you would look at the man, the suffering man, and you would scarcely know he's human. Like, if that's not covenant love, I don't know what you're looking for, because what you're looking for is Jesus. What you're looking for is God, his love. He so loved you that he gave his son to be crushed by sin so that you could be free. and live for Him. There's no other love like this. Holy Spirit, we thank You this morning. Go to John chapter 15. If you don't have your Bible, no worries. Put it on the screen. Jesus speaking. I am the true vine, my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, He takes away. Every branch that does bear fruit, He prunes, that it may bear more fruit. Already you are clean because of the word that I have spoken to you. You know, the moment you receive Jesus, you are instantaneously forgiven of all of your sin. Yeah, the moment you receive Him, you're clean. The moment you receive His word, it's like, I don't feel clean. Well, I don't care what you feel. This is what the Bible says. When you get born again, when you give your life to Jesus, you're clean. You might not see yourself as clean, but that's just because you got the wrong glasses on. You got some warped thinking that needs to be rectified. But you're clean. You're changed. Well, don't I have to do something else for God for Him to accept me? No. You're accepted in the Beloved. You couldn't work yourself into salvation, and don't you think for a second that you can work your way out of it. His blood is enough. His grace is enough. Where sin abounds, grace abounds much more. At the core of you, you're changed. What's up for grabs is your time. What's up for grabs is your money. What's up for grabs is the essence of your life. What are you going to do with the covenant God has given you? You know, I'm very aware these days, my marriage to Carly is up for grabs. The quality of my marriage, the fruitfulness of my marriage, the love relationship in our marriage. If I do things to compromise our relationship, and I don't want to do things to compromise her. I have done things, and she's done things to me. That's every marriage, right?
Yeah.
Every relationship. But I'm saying, God, I want the best marriage.
Yeah.
How do I love? I keep thinking, like, almost like every day this week, I'm just like, I just so love my wife, and I should get her flowers. And then I just remember the last time I got her flowers. I had done something dumb. I can't even remember what it was. And I brought her flowers. She goes, how much did you spend on those flowers? I'm like, oh, can't even get her flowers. And she liked them afterwards, but she's a penny pincher, right? And I'm the opposite. I'm a free spirit. She's the calculator, the bean counter. And I'm like, money's meant to give it away, whatever. There's always more where that came from. God owns the cattle on 1,000 hills. But what's up for grabs is your calling in God. What He has for you. And it's more than just to sit on a seat in church 2 or 3 times a month. Whenever you can get there, whenever you feel, I need a little dose of God. Come and get a dose of God. He'll touch you. You turn to Him, He's there. But you're made in His image and likeness. You have a will. I remember preaching in England one time, and they brought me into this classroom, and they call it sixth form, which is grade 12. I'm standing in front of this grade 12 class and telling my testimony, and one of the young guys puts his hand up and says, if God is real, how come there's so much suffering in the world? Poverty, people going hungry. All this stuff. I said, all right, everyone in here. I said, put up your right hand. Put up your right hand right now. Put it up. Everyone here, put up your right hand. Okay, put it down. Okay, why did you do that? No. I told you to. Did you have to? No. Just because somebody tells you to do something doesn't mean you have to do it. Okay, put up your left hand. Put it up, put it up, put it up, put it up. Hey. Why did you do that?
You told me.
I know I told you that. You don't have to listen to me. Who am I? Just some dude. Okay, now, Bill, get on the floor and bark like a dog. Man. Come on, man. Do it. What am I saying? I said to those 12, six formers, I said, who here could spare 20 quid a month? It's 20 pounds. It's like bucks to dollars, quid to pounds, right? Who here could spare 20 pounds a month to support and rescue a child out of poverty? All the hands went up. I said, who here is doing it? No hands went up. I said, you have no right to complain about poverty in the world when you are doing nothing about it.
Here you go.
Don't complain about it. Do something about it. The Bible says the heavens, even the highest of heavens, are the Lord's, but the earth he has given to the sons of men. Your earth, our city, our country, our responsibility. One of my employees, his aunt, just one of my boy Joe Val. We moved his aunt and his aunt's boyfriend some couple of years ago, actually 18 months ago, and I met Joe Val. I'm inviting Joe Val. He's come a couple times, and he says he's gonna come next week. I'm inviting him. Come on, Joe Val, get to church, man. And I saw his aunt maybe a month ago, and I said, hey, you told me you were coming to church. She goes, oh, no, I don't need church. I got this blah, 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 blah. 2 weeks ago, she was in Montreal doing whatever, partying or whatever, hanging out, slipped on the ground, hit her head, died that night.
Wow.
Dead. Had an aneurysm or whatever, died in her sleep. 2 weeks before, I had shared Jesus with her again. And it was like a divine encounter. I just saw her in a hallway when we were doing a move. And I said, hey, come on out to church. God's got something for you. God gave her another chance. One of the most marked moments in my life was when I was in Toronto preaching, wherever we were doing it, God said, go talk to that guy in the wheelchair. I said, sir, I'd like to tell you about Jesus. And he used some colorful language with me. Basically said, get the out of here. I don't want to know about Jesus. I said, God, like, you usually bring me to people that are open. And the Holy Spirit spoke to my heart and said, son, I wanted to give him one more chance. I wanted to give him another chance. Okay. And I just feel this way. God is just wanting to move you toward his path, toward his will. And you have so many excuses. And he knows them all. Verse 4, abide in me and I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, it is he that bears much fruit. For apart from me you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he is thrown away like a branch and withers, and the branches are gathered, thrown into the fire and burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. By this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit, and so prove to be my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you, and that your joy may be full. Love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that someone lays down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do whatever I command you. No longer do I call you servants. For a servant does not know what his master is doing, but I've called you friends. I remember praying one day on my knees. I just felt Jesus say, stand up, and I stood up, and he says, you're my friend. I just started weeping. I said, what do you mean I'm your friend? He said, you're my friend because you walk with me. You're my friend. So isn't every one of your friends? We sing at church, I am a friend. Who ever sung this song before? I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. Right? I get so grieved in my heart when I see people singing that. And I'm thinking, I just said, God, yeah, they're not your friend. A friend loves it all. A friend doesn't forsake. But some believers, they forsake Jesus all the time. Just do their own thing. Walk their own way. I do it too sometimes. I'm not saying I'm perfect. But I want to be consistent. I want to walk with Jesus. Message is tough in a democratic society where everyone gets a vote. Everyone's voice is important. It's true, it is. Your voice is important. You do get a vote in Canada. But the kingdom of God is not a democracy. Jesus is not President Jesus. He's not Prime Minister Jesus. He's King Jesus.
Amen.
And we actually don't get a vote like when he speaks something to you, when he says, I want to heal you, it's not up for debate. When he says, I got a calling on your life, it's fixed. It is what it is. And we get to choose if we want to walk in it. Isn't that awesome? And you can do, who here knows, you can do grade 3 again if you fail. You can do grade 5 again. I think one of the most challenging things about absolutely walking in God's call for your life is that He doesn't call you to please people. You know me, I'll get up and I'll crack jokes and I think church should be fun. There's a moment today where the spirit of the fear of the Lord is upon us. Right now, today. October 29th, 2017. And for many of you, there's a crossroads right now. You're at a crossroads. God's calling you down His path, the way, the holy way. He's calling you down His path. You've been wrestling with God. That's why do we do encounter? Just so we can do another thing? No, because men get set free. Women get set free when they go and they experience the cross and they experience forgiveness and they experience sexual relationship, the relationships the way God meant them to be, and they experience purity, and they experience the Holy Ghost, and they experience the Father's love, and they're changed, and they get a better chance to make an impact, to make a mark for God. One of my favorite movies is Gladiator. I know it's bloody and whatever, right? I don't watch it if you don't like that stuff, but for whatever reason, I just love it. I don't love blood and guts, I'm just saying, but I love there's truth that speaks to me. Right at the beginning of the movie, you know, the commander, Maximus Aurelius, he's encouraging his guys, and he knows many of them are about to die, and he says to them, what you do in this life echoes in eternity. And I want to tell you, what you do in this life, I remember pushing through one time when I was young, and God said, go preach to that guy. And I went and I preached to this guy, and I gave him what God, and God spoke to me, and He said, son, You just did more than many believers will do in their entire lives. Just from tackling that spirit of fear and saying, I will not let a spirit of fear dominate my life. I'm not going to let fear dominate my life. I'm not going to let the fear of the unknown dominate my life. I'm going to let the Spirit of God dominate my life. I'm going to let the Word of God get inside of me and dominate my life. God, I choose to be yoked to you. I choose to be chained to you. I choose you. God, I choose you. I choose your ways. Hallelujah. If that's you this morning and you know, a crossroads is just a place of, maybe you're just doubting. In fact, there are people in here that you've even doubted recently. God, are you even real? Are you even there? Are you even real? There's about 5 people in this room, I feel like, that's where you're at. And God, even in this moment, is because you know that, you've been asking that, and God is saying to you, I am real. I am real. What was that movie, Carly, we went to watch that one time? The Gray. Don't recommend it. Was it The Gray? It was nasty. We went to the theaters and we saw this. It was like a thriller, right? The Gray with the wolves. Big wolves and stuff. Anyway, whatever. We went and saw this movie, and at the end of the movie, the main character says, God is not real, and you're not even there, are you? It was like this moment in the movie, and everyone in the theater, and I look over at Carly, and she said, go ahead, preach. Because she knew I was gonna. This might be crazy to you, but I stood up in the theater, and there's, I don't know, 40, 50, I don't know how many people there are, and I said, I just want to tell you, that God is real. Jesus is real and he's changed my life and he loves you and he wants you to know that he's real. Okay, bye. Right? So I just can't take it. Like I'm not gonna sit there and that, you know, and let that thing hang over those people. I just gotta break it off. He's real, baby. There's some of us that are doubting. And I remember when I first got saved, I remember when I first got saved and I doubted. I'm like, God, is this actually real? Have you actually touched my life? Can I actually walk with you? But I just tell you, as I walked with Jesus and as I read the Word, I just got to know God day by day. It became, relationship with God got stronger and eventually that doubt just left. Some of us are at a crossroads with the message spoken last week. Right? And what's up for grabs right now is your inheritance. What's up for grabs right now is are you going to walk down the path that God has called you to walk down? Or are you going to do your own thing? In a nutshell, the message spoke last week was, are you going to do your relationship the way God calls you to do it? Or are you going to walk in sexual immorality? You know, it's a crossroads, right? You get to choose. Everyone say, I? I get to choose. It's not up to anybody else. It's up to you. You're made in his image and his likeness. And you get to choose. The supreme power of choice has been endowed by God to each one of us. So if that's you, if you're at a crossroads with one of those two things or anything else in your life and you're feeling like, God, here I am, and you're wrestling right now. It's my assignment is to go, just get the right way. Go the right way. Go God's way. So if that's you, I'd just like you to stand up. If it's you, if you are truly at a crossroads, where God, you know God is calling you, and it is a struggle right now. Let's go. four or five, there's five people that you're even doubting. Jesus, are you even there? Are you even real? Just be bold. Look at all these people standing. Nobody's judging you. Okay, you recognize by standing up, you're deciding to go God's way, right? Mm-hmm. This is what this is for. Yeah. Not just standing up and saying, well, I am at a crossroads. That's me. I know it's you. Just close your eyes right now if you're standing. You know what, there's two more people that are fighting right now. And just stand up if that's you and you'll say, God, I know I want to go your way, but oh, it's so hard. And God will give you grace. He will give you grace. He will give you grace. If that's you, He will give you grace. He will give you strength. That word in the Greek, strengthen, is the Greek word endunamun. And it means that God will put His strength inside of you. He'll put His strength inside of you. So right now, just close your eyes, put your hand on your heart. Put your hand on your heart. Holy Spirit, thank you right now. I thank you right now for the spirit of the fear of the Lord and the spirit of knowledge, just the sevenfold, the wisdom of God right now. Just fall upon your people. Lord, help them. Go the way that you're calling them to go. Give them your power. Strengthen them from the inside. Let it be transformation from the inside out. Close with this. Keep standing. People that aren't standing, I just want you to get a hand on somebody who's standing up and just get over to them. Just get up, stand up, walk over to them. Put your arm around them. And just begin to pray for them out loud. Just begin to pray for them. I don't hear people praying. Pray for them. Lord, strengthen this man. Strengthen this woman. Lord, Holy Spirit, come. Bring your strength. Bring your wisdom. Bring your direction. Bring your vision. Let every dark cloud that isn't of God, well, dark clouds aren't of God, let every dark cloud just blow away right now. Just blow wind of God. Just blow in this place. Holy Spirit, just blow in this place. Blow that stuff away. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. I will seek you, Lord. I am in my youth. I will praise you, Lord. I'll proclaim your truth. For you searched and found me, and I was far away. In my troubled times, you'll always stay the same. Oh, 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 oh. Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I fear? Hallelujah. The Lord is my light, my salvation. Thank you, Jesus.
Well, we just bless you in Jesus' name. God has given you the power to follow Him. This is grace. He's given you the power to choose. Choose life. Choose life. Choose life. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. I tell you again, God loves you, He's with you, and He's given you the authority. Hallelujah. If you would like prayer, we'd love to pray for you.